So when the Democratic appointed justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg criticized Republican presidential nominee Donald Trump, she triggered concerns about judicial ethics. But the political concerns were even more serious. Has this partisan turn made the court less independent and less trustworthy than the nation requires? With a term ending in 2016, it included more decisions and developments in almost 50 years for analyzing this question. Among them were major issues, major cases about abortion rights, the death penalty, immigration, and other wedge issues, as well as the death of Justice Antonin G. Scalia, leaving the court evenly divided between conservatives and liberals. Legal journalist Lincoln Caplan dissects the recent term, puts it in its historical context, and recommends ways to strengthen trust in the Supreme Court as a pinnacle of the American constitutional system. William Finnegan, the Pulitzer Prize-winning author of Barbarian Days and Cold New World, says of Caplan in this book that it's a timely, essential primer on Supreme Court questions, both perennial and urgent. Lincoln Caplan nails this deadlock moment, puts the question of politics in the court in succinct historical context, draws wicked character sketches, and proposes specific reforms to bolster the court's legitimacy. Paul Glastris of the Washington Monthly says that in this masterful analysis of the Supreme Court's 2015 term, Lincoln Caplan persuasively argues that there's no good reason to deny that the court is a deeply political institution, and that with the right reforms, there's every reason to celebrate that fact. Lincoln Caplan himself is a senior research scholar and the Truman Capote Visiting Lecturer in Law at Yale Law School. He's the author of The Tenth Justice, The Solicitor General and the Rule of Law, Scaddan, Power, Money, and the Rise of a Legal Empire, Up Against the Law, Affirmative Action in the Supreme Court, and many other books about legal affairs. He's a regular contributor to the New Yorker website, a member of the editorial board of the American Scholar, and a contributing editor of Harvard Magazine. He's also written about the Supreme Court as a member of the editorial board of the New York Times. So if you will, please join me in welcoming Lincoln Caplan.
So there are dear friends and family here, and as a provincial, I experienced this great institution mostly by watching C-SPAN, and I'm delighted to say that you all look younger and more spiritually fulfilled than you do on C-SPAN. One of the things that I have loved most about covering the Supreme Court is arriving there on a day like today where it's sunny and the mica in the marble of the Supreme Court building is shimmering. It emphasizes the dignity of the building and its high importance. The court building was designed to be a temple of justice. It was designed to look like that, but to give the institution that sense of purpose. And what you see in the artwork of the building really emphasizes that aspiration. One of my favorite works of art are the giant bronze doors that we're not allowed to go through these days because of security, but that are magnificent beyond the columns. If you look closely, you'll see that there are eight scenes that all depict the evolution of justice. The first one is the lower left. It's a bas-relief of two characters in Homer's Iliad, and they're debating a point of primitive law, but what really matters, the point they're making, is that except in times of war, the court is the place to peaceably resolve differences. And the theme works its way up to the panel in the upper right, and that's a portrait of Chief Justice John Marshall and Justice Joseph Story, who served on the court for 24 years together in the 19th century and both considered great justices. And the point of that art, every piece of art in the building, is to lift our sights, to have the sense that law is separate from politics, that law rises above politics. And that's really the way that our culture is encouraged, especially by the court itself, to talk about what the Supreme Court does, to think about law as distinct from politics, even at its most controversial. Anyone who studied the history of the court knows that at the moment when that art was revealed in October 1935, 81 Octobers ago, The court was as far as it could be from that ideal. This was in the thick of the Great Depression. FDR and the Congress had been elected to use the government to address the problems of the Great Depression. And the court and FDR were at loggerheads. In this bookstore, you can buy a wonderful book by Jeff Chesall, which is called Supreme Power, FDR versus the Supreme Court. And it tells better than anyone has before of how FDR first tried to persuade the court that that it should defer to Congress in the legislation that Congress passed to use the government to address the problems of our economy, to regulate business, to provide social support. But by 1937, it was absolutely clear that the court wanted nothing to do with that. It had struck down every piece of major legislation that the FDR proposed and that Congress passed. And so, with great support from Congress, and in some ways Congress taking the lead, though FDR was the chief proponent, the court backing plan was put forward, which would be a way to address the adversarial relationship between the court and the New Deal. And FDR made one big mistake, and that was he didn't want to take the court on political grounds because he didn't want to be insulting. So he used the pretext that the court system was inefficient, and if it had extra justices and extra judges on each of the courts, the Federal District Court and the Courts of Appeals, then this problem could be addressed and would go away. And Charles Evans Hughes, who FDR described as the most able politician in the United States, just beat him at his own game. And he put together a report saying, we're absolutely up to date on business, we don't need any more judges, and we don't need any more justices in particular. And the court backing scheme was defeated. But nobody at that time had the sense of what the art was supposed to convince us of. Everybody understood that the politics of the country and the law were so intertwined that you could not tell them apart. And I start there because there isn't anyone who studied this period who disagrees about that. And it's easy for us to see through that history that this intertwining was so counter to the conception that the court itself encourages us to have, but also journalism about the court encourages us to have as well. And the reality is that saying that the court is a political institution is like saying we have a global economy. It's just a description, it's just a fact, and there's some uncontroversial aspects of it. We have an elected president whose job is to pick nominees for the court when there's an opening. We have an elected Senate whose job is to provide consent in response to those nominations and to act on those. And we have an understanding that law is a way of expressing political choices, of expressing policy, of being politics in its most practical sense, and also to discipline politics so that politics doesn't get so vitriolic that it's out of hand. And the controversial aspect of what politics is what makes this moment so interesting about our country and the court. When Justice Elena Kagan was confirmed to the Supreme Court and took the seat of Justice John Paul Stevens in 2010, there began a pattern of votes in the major ideological decisions of the court that we'd never seen before in American history. At that moment, for the first time, there was not just ideological divisions on the court, and there had been those since the end of the 18th century, but those ideological decisions were expressed in terms of partisanship. That is, five conservatives, 60% of the time in ideological cases from 2010 until the beginning of the term that I write about, which began last fall and ended in June. In 60% of those cases, the division was 5 conservatives appointed by Republicans and 4 moderate liberals, or liberals, if you will, appointed by Democrats. And this was first noted and described in very careful terms by Adam Liptak in the New York Times, and then many of the leading commentators and reporters on the court picked up this theme when it was germane in particular cases. And it's absolutely clear that, Chief Justice John Roberts doesn't spend much of his time talking with the press and believes the way to communicate is through his work. Occasionally, he'll have a public conversation and in which he gives you an insight about what matters most to him. And in early February this year, in Boston, he had a public conversation with the dean of the law school there, in which he said very pointedly in response to this view, we don't vote as Republicans and Democrats. And about 10 days later, when Justice Scalia on that Saturday died very unexpectedly, the Chief Justice's observation suddenly seemed very quaint. Every observation about the court from then until now has been about how, in the critical cases, they do vote as Republicans and Democrats. It's not that they're voting as party members who are on strings connected to party bosses. It's that the nature of the court and the nature of selection means that by the time the Senate confirms a justice, it can be pretty sure about how he or she is going to vote in major ideologically tinged cases. The book I wrote and I'm delighted to have published now, just this week, is part of a series that the University of Pennsylvania Press started 2 years ago. My friend and a reporter about the Supreme Court I greatly admire, Garrett Epps, did the first volume. His is a wonderful portrait of the 9 justices on the court then. Through a close reading of an opinion by each of them, and Garrett set a very high standard. When I was asked if I would be interested in proposing a book for this series, I said that I had wanted to have an excuse for a number of years now to read the literature about the court as a political institution in a way I hadn't done. By the time we came to an agreement about this, it was December, and I'd say that my editor at Penn Press thought it was a potentially good organizing theme for the year, and by February he had no more doubts when Justice Scalia died, and everyone, whether commentators on the left or the right, came to the same conclusion, which is whoever filled the Scalia seat was going to change the character of the court. If President Obama's nominee were confirmed the way people expected at that point, it was very likely that the court would take a liberal turn in a way that it had not for a half a century. And if anyone doubted whether the court is involved with politics as a political institution, by the time the Senate Majority Leader McConnell and the head of the Senate Judiciary Committee, Senator Grassley, had articulated their edict that the election should decide who gets to fill that seat, and therefore they were not going to consider the nomination of Judge Merrick Garland when President Obama announced him in March. It was absolutely clear that the court could not escape the sense that it was embroiled in politics. There's a political science literature that began to develop in this country in the 1940s and 1950s, heavily in the 1950s in response to Brown versus Board of Education, which was an enormously divisive case and really still is. It's ironically considered the most important decision that the court made in the 20th century, but there's wide disagreement about what it stands for at this point. And political scientists wanted to make some sense of this. And a leading one from Yale, Robert Dahl, said with some bemusement, of course the court is a political institution. It's very hard for Americans to say that and accept that. And at the same time, they know that it has to absolutely be the case because of cases like Brown versus Board of Education, where they've run out of law. The law doesn't answer the question before the court, which is whether the Constitution should outlaw segregation in public schools. And one of my favorite political scientists, Lee Epstein of Washington University, describes the court from 1969, when Warren Berger was appointed Chief Justice by Richard Nixon, through William Rehnquist, appointed by President Reagan, and finally John Roberts, appointed by George W. Bush, as the Republican Court. And one of the things that I wanted to do was to understand why that was so, to track through the political science back in a way that political scientists tend not to, through doctrine about the court. That is, how it decides, how it uses law to decide questions of law, but also that have political content. Of course, there are major exceptions, like Roe v. Wade, like the same-sex marriage decision of a couple of years ago, where the court, responding to the changed politics of the country, in a sense ratifies a choice that the country has already made, and saying in law that this liberal outcome is right under law as well as right in policy. But in many fields, criminal law, civil rights law, corporate law, First Amendment law, the court has just moved systematically to the right over the last 47 years. And so we're now at the beginning of the 48th year of the Republican court led by a conservative Chief Justice. One of the most important things that I learned that I didn't know about the court and about American politics, one of the most striking to me was from Evans Witt, who's a great pollster. And when I wanted to get a sense from him about what he learned about from a public opinion about the standing of the court, he said that a decade ago, when you asked people to define themselves, they defined themselves by their family and by their gender and by their religion, by their place, by their work, and it was the sixth or seventh thing on the list before they got to their political party, if they mentioned it at all. And today, he said, and this is why the Garland nomination was treated as nothing more than a political choice, despite the fact, in a way, ironically, that he was a distinctly well-respected judge across the ideological spectrum, respected as much by his conservative colleagues on the D.C. Circuit as liberal colleagues, is that people think of themselves first and foremost as Republicans and Democrats, and it affects social life, but it certainly affects the way politics is being carried out. One of the questions that I couldn't stop thinking about when doing this book was, what's the connection between this partisan character for the court now in a way that we haven't seen before, and Donald Trump's disrespect for the rule of law, really angry, vociferous, relentless attacks on the rule of law. And there's not an easy, simple, direct connection, but if you go back to Bush v. Gore in 2000, when the Supreme Court did two remarkable things. One, it decided who would be a president of the United States and really picked George W. Bush to be president. And the second thing it did was even more remarkable, which it said was, this is not a precedent. What we have decided applies only to these facts. So what it said was, we're going to exempt ourselves from the rule of law, from from rules of law that we have made about deference to state legal processes, deference to states deciding how their political processes in particular operate, so that the Florida Supreme Court should have made the decision about the continuation of the recount from the Bush-Gore election. But we're exempting this decision from that rule of law. It will have no meaning going forward. And of course, it didn't just decide that George W. Bush would be president, it decided who would select William Rehnquist's successor as Chief Justice, and who would select Sandra Day O'Connor's successor as a justice. And those choices are at the center of the partisan divide that the court now has on the left and the right. And of course, the institution that we would expect in some way, even indirectly, to speak to that is the Supreme Court. And the Supreme Court is silenced. It's in a kind of enforced repose, treated with enormous disrespect by the Senate, really treated in an unconstitutional way by the Senate, though it'll take a while for our politics to express that. And so it's been silent and diminished in some sense. Because I couldn't quite figure out what I thought about all this by the time I needed to hand in my manuscript 30 days after the end of the Supreme Court term, I decided to jump right ahead to how to fix the problem, even if I couldn't quite define it. And one conclusion that I reach is that we should amend the Constitution and change how we select justices, that justices should have 18-year terms and have a new justice selected every 2 years. If that had been the case when Richard Nixon was elected president, rather than having in the period when of the most recent 16 justices who have been appointed, including chief justices, 12 of them picked by Republican presidents, we would have had 24 picked by Republicans and 14 by Democrats. The terms would have been shorter, though 18 years is a long term for a judge. And of course, that's not going to happen, but it frames the consequence of the system we have now, when in the 19th century, in the 18th and 19th century, everyone thought of law itself as something knowable and setting a limit on the court, and no one believes that anymore. I also think that while coverage of the court has never been better than it is today, the people who cover the court are knowledgeable about law and gifted as journalists in a way that allows them to capture the essential character of cases in a remarkably short period of time in a way that is helpful and accurate, that we need to reconceive the way we have the court covered. My friend Garrett Epps, who writes for The Atlantic, I think is the model of that we should all aspire to. He is a professor of constitutional law and knows that stuff cold. He happens also to be a novelist and to write beautifully, but he has a knowledge of history and politics, so that every explanation of a case or a series of cases is in the context of what gets left out of most coverage. Most journalism really is focusing on legal reasoning as if there is no context, and that the context is clearly enormously important for the institution now. And let me end by talking about notorious RBG, Ruth Bader Ginsburg. When she made the comment that she did about Donald Trump, when she called him a faker this summer at the end of the term, her observations were mild. Republicans were saying far worse things about Trump than she did. And the first instinct among her fans was to think, good for her, brilliant and brave, once again, saying what other people don't have the courage to say. But the problem is that what she said, according to the code of conduct that applies to every other set of federal judges in the country, except for the justices of the Supreme Court, is that it was explicitly unethical what she did. There's a prohibition which says that a federal judge should not comment about an election, pro or con, and she clearly did. And in the most technical sense, what she did was not unethical, because the justices are not bound by that code of conduct. And they're not bound by that, even though the Senate has been eager to persuade the court to adopt the code as binding on the justices, because the Chief Justice of the United States has said, when the Senate has pushed that, we don't need to be bound that way because we all observe the code of conduct. And clearly the lesson of Justice Ginsburg's inappropriate remarks was that they don't feel bound by it. And the Chief Justice may have been speaking for himself, but he wasn't speaking for her or for other justices who have had similar comments criticized. So I think that one thing that's really important to make sure that there isn't a connection between Bush v. Gore and the disrespect for the court that engendered, and Donald Trump's attacks on the rule of law, is that the justices make very clear to the rest of the country that while they represent the pinnacle of the constitutional system in the country, and they are the court of last resort, and therefore a different kind of court that can't be overruled by anybody, that they're bound by the principles of ethics that they want all federal judges to be bound by. It's a gesture. It would be a gesture of modesty that we used to expect in terms of self-restraint on the part of the court since Bush v. Gore and Citizens United and the Shelby County voting rights cases and many other cases. It's a kind of self-restraint that we don't expect the court to exercise. But in this case, by focusing on the ethical constraints and admitting their utility, very occasionally, as in the case of Justice Ginsburg, it would be an important gesture. And why is that? This will be my last point. Every theory about the court turns on the court's legitimacy. And over the last generation, not surprisingly, as there's been a highly engaged conservative court, a liberal response has been to argue that the court shouldn't have the power to overturn statutes, that the court should have a much more limited role, that the over-empowerment of the court has led to all kinds of political problems. And always the argument in favor of any theory about how the court should operate is legitimacy. So the argument on the left has been the court is losing its legitimacy. And the most surprising thing I learned doing this project was that we have no good measure for legitimacy. Right now, it's really public opinion polls which treat the court and the court's decisions as if they're made by the Senate or a political institution. And if you like the result, great, and if you don't like the result, too bad. And in the most recent careful round of public opinion, which was done in the summer of 2015, 70% of people who were surveyed said that they considered the court a political institution. And my conclusion is that what's difficult about this issue, and really fascinating, is that the court is a political institution, but it's also a legal one. And the responsibility of the justices, who of course want us to think about what they do as law, is that while making decisions that have undeniable political content, they also have to make decisions that are worthy of respect as law, as arguments about law, as careful applications of precedent or distinguishing of precedent. And if they don't do that, then the sense that they left us with after Bush v. Gore is really the sense that we should have about the court. I'm going to stop there. I'm happy to take questions, and please. I think you're supposed to say who you are and say the question loud enough so we can all hear it.
Okay. So hello, thank you so much for your talk. My name's Koichi Shirayanagi. I'm recently finished an internship at Reuters, where I worked alongside Joan Biskupic, who was the reporter who got the conversation with RBG that led to all of that. So it was a very interesting summer for me. I wanted to ask you about one of Joan's other reporting about the echo chamber. I'm sure you're familiar with her reporting about how there's a lot of it. Your last 30 minutes was about was this left-right, Democrats-Republicans Supreme Court. But what Reuters reported, which was so fascinating and was a Pulitzer finalist, was the whole like corporate business, the way that an increasingly small number of lawyers are arguing cases before the court, and those lawyers happen to be paid the most and the most pro-corporate and kind of going in that direction. So, whether it's a Democratic court or a Republican court, you see sort of that impact of the echo chamber on the court in the future, and how would you go about, solving that problem?
Sure. So let me respond to that. That's an astute question. So Richard Lazarus is a professor now at Harvard Law School. He was at Georgetown for many years, and he did a first-rate piece of thinking and research that was published, I think, in 2008 or 2009 about the disproportionate impact on the court's decisions about which cases to take or not, coming from a relatively small group of lawyers who had all been in the office of the Solicitor General and then moved on to private practice. This is an interest of mine because one of my books is about the office of the Solicitor General and what happened to that office in the Reagan administration. And at that time, what was interesting is that most of the people who were in that office were lifers and really had no ambition to move out into private practice. There were former Solicitors General who became judges, about a third of them, across American history, but most went to the academy or some role that was not continuing to focus on influencing court decisions. And what he found was that because of the elite expertise they developed about how the court reasons and how it decides to take cases, that these graduates of the office, some of them former SGs themselves, but many who had more junior roles in a very small office, 20 to 23 lawyers. And as a result, because they were hired by corporate clients, the court's business-oriented docket and its business-friendly decisions skyrocketed. And Joan Biskupic, with a team of economists and other kinds of researchers, did a kind of documentation of this and showed that really 69 lawyers, I think was her number, had a stunning success rate in getting petitions for certiorari accepted by the court. A footnote here, the Supreme Court's different from all other federal courts in that it basically decides its own docket. It's freed from having to take cases the way the lower federal courts have to. And so that means that influence on behalf of clients being persuasive is really important. And Richard Lazarus' suggestion was that that pro bono work by lawyers be extended to interests that can't afford to pay corporate rates, so that their cert petitions, as they're called, are handled by lawyers with the same kind of skill and the same kind of expertise. You see that in death penalty cases, and the court has taken, in the last 20 years in particular, a disproportionate number of cases dealing with aspects of the death penalty. But his idea is that you spread that around. to me, the most astonishing thing about the disputed piece was that they talked to all of the justices, except for the Chief Justice, who thought it was inappropriate to talk with them. And all of the justices, according to Joan Biskuper, thought that this was great, that the higher quality the lawyering before the court, the higher quality work they could do. And they were either unwilling to address the political, in the kind of deepest sense, consequences of corporations being represented in a way that distorted the court docket on their behalf. I think it's a hugely important issue, but there are so many others for the court that it's not going to get the attention you think it deserves, and I agree with you.
So I'm Dr. Caroline Poplin. I'm a physician now, but I'm also an attorney. I graduated from Yale Law School. I was originally in Hillary's original class. I started in 1969. When I was there, it was a terribly exciting place. The decisions that we studied were the Warren Court, and it looked like just a steady move of progress to as the Warren Court proceeded. And I realized when I finally graduated, I practiced law for a while, that I was going to be on defense for the rest of my life. That the court, in the time I was at law school, had switched and was moving backwards from my point of view. You've talked about Republicans and Democrats and, you know, how the court is evenly split, but it seems to me that the Republicans, that's why I became a physician, I just left.
So the question is?
The question is, it seems to me that the Republicans, the Democrats choose moderates, and the Republicans go as far to the right as they think they can get away with. And Merrick Garland is a perfect example. He's acceptable to everyone except this year. And that's forced the course to the right, because the Democrats are willing to split the difference and say, well, if you give us some, we'll give you some. And the Republicans aren't willing to at all. This is our position, and this is what it is, and we're not going to compromise, and vote with us or against us.
So let me respond to that. One of the consistent criticisms of the academy, colleges and universities, is that everybody is a liberal, everybody votes for Democrats, it's an echo chamber. And in the legal academy, at least for the last generation, most of the energy and much of the influence has come from the right. The best example is law and economics, which is clearly the most influential movement in the law in the last 60 years, and much of it oriented to articulating free market principles and incentives in law. And there's no question that first in the Nixon administration, when he campaigned against the court on a law and order platform, and then had the good fortune of making four appointments in very short succession from 69 to 72. And then, even more importantly, in the Reagan administration, there's been a tremendous recognition on the part of the Republican Party that there's an opportunity to shape politics by deciding who goes on federal courts, in particular, who goes on the Supreme Court. And there hasn't been a Democratic response to that, in part because the Democratic Party hasn't had something to rally around the way the Republican Party did in two ways. One of them is the law and economics movement, which had so much energy that it kind of gathered force. The other was to have the Warren Court to criticize. There's a wonderful biography of Chief Justice Warren by James Newton, who was editorial writer for the LA Times, and it was one of the books that I wanted to read slowly and carefully as part of this project. And the Warren Court was not the Warren Court as described by the Republican Party over the years. It was turned into a cartoon. Warren was a moderate Republican who had some liberal instincts, but really was a kind of shaper of consensus, and the court was really controlled by moderates until its last section, and all of the cases that we think about as the big Warren Court cases were really from roughly 6 years, 1962 to 68.
Brennan and Marshall.
I think really the most interesting part of the story is that the Clinton administration made a political calculation that in part because he was elected with less than a majority of voters, and in part because he had campaigned as a centrist Democrat, that they were not going to make a priority of trying to appoint the kind of intellectual muscle in the federal courts that would combat the Scalias and the Easterbrooks and others who were the intellectual heavyweights. One of the things that's really striking about the justices who President Obama has appointed is that they have that muscle. And my view is that Justice Kagan is the best writer on the court since Justice Brandeis, and has conceptual abilities that we've just begun to see in her work. And Justice Sotomayor, especially in criminal justice and the death penalty, has shown heart as well as mind. Vote for Hillary and get all your friends too.
I hope you're
Hi, my name is Kevin Acia, and I'm from American University, here representing my class of Writing for Communications. We have to do a speaker's event, and I chose this one. Partly because, as you know, the Supreme Court is highly polarizing in this next election. I know you've already spoken about legitimacy of the court, but would you say that there's a growing national consensus for state Supreme Courts to be deciding on decisions rather than the Supreme Court?
No.
As we saw, the Alabama Supreme Court justice struck down the same-sex marriage, and
no.
Now he's resigned. Okay, I have one more question for you. That was quick. What do you think the power of impartiality is?
Repeat the question.
What do you think the power of impartiality is?
Limitless. It's the characteristic that we count on most of all from the judges at every level. And in any way that we doubt the impartiality of a judge or a justice, then justice is in some ways contaminated for us. So that's why when conflicts of interest are talked about, it's not just impartiality, but the appearance of it that matters just as much. And it's why when we think about how courts, whether state courts or federal courts, decide decisions of whether a judge should hear a case or not, or recuse herself or not, you never want the judge to be deciding her own case. And it's precisely because the power of the appearance of impartiality is limitless, and the power of that attribute itself is. So thanks for the questions.
Thank you.
Hi, Mike. I'm Jim Fowler, a longtime friend. Look forward to reading this book. We bought numerous copies, too, so I urge everyone to do the same. I have a what is to be done question. So I'm glad to hear you, as a legal expert, have this 18-year term every 2 years idea, because that's something that to me as a layman has always seemed appealing. The question is whether there's any possibility at all of that ever happening. And to use the example of the Electoral College, one of many reasons I was hoping John Kerry would have won in 2004 is you could have had then in 2000 and 2004 reverse circumstances of the popular vote loser be the Electoral College winner. Both parties would have an incentive to go after the Electoral College. It's hard to see for as similarly fundamental a change as getting rid of life tenure of the Supreme Court and assuming there's, ensuring there's an even flow of appointments. Is this something you think might actually happen? So quite, might this actually happen? What would it take to have the paralyzed Senate, and then the whole process of constitutional amendment make it happen? Failing that, are you saying that the only sort of route back towards sanity is just continuing to elect democratic presence and just letting actuarial forces go. So what is to be done from your point of view?
So I don't think that the partisan divide that we now have on the court is necessarily a permanent pattern. I think it's, politics is deeply polarized in a way that you and others in the Atlantic have written about so well, and that will raise the chances that this pattern will continue. There are Republicans who, on lower courts, vote with people who were appointed by Democrats, and there is much more diversity across partisan lines on other courts. I do put faith in the press, and I do think that the way we cover the court has to change. The court insists that it's not a political institution, and doesn't get called on that. And I think that the way we cover the court has to be much more the way Garrett Epps is doing that, which is to explain the political valence of decisions as well as the legal ones, and really to play back to the court that this self-imposed hypocrisy just isn't going to work. I do think it would make that the Ginsburg incident and many others give the Senate a real impetus for imposing on the court an ethical code of conduct that would avoid what Ginsburg did, but also play back to the court in a way that political scientists believe really have an effect on its behavior, it can't be forever empowered. I also put my faith in a peculiarity of the liberal justices, who I generally describe as moderate liberals. The school of thought that most appeals to me is one that's really old and not in great favor. It's called the legal process school. And the difference between the people who believe in judicial restraint and this idea is that judicial restraint people believe that the right thing for the court to do is just to throttle back in its exercise of an authority. But the problem with that is that it assumes a kind of static model where we have a restrained executive and we have an engaged Congress and all of the parts of government are doing their jobs. And what we have is an over-empowered executive. At the same time, we have an over-empowered court and a dysfunctional Congress. And so the legal process school is a kind of studied and skeptical one, which believes that the court should decide issues that it has to decide, and otherwise should steer decisions to the right place in our political system. And the members of the court who act most like that happen to be the moderate liberals. Certainly, Justice Breyer and Justice Ginsburg much of the time. So. In that sense, I think especially if we have a fifth justice who's a liberal or a moderate liberal, what I think you'll find is that the new leadership will seek a kind of collegiality, but also a coherence that raises the chances that decisions are embraced as law, and minimizes decisions like Citizens United, where the court takes a decision that should have been a narrow decision about the application of a statute and instead transforms constitutional law. But it's a messy process, and what's most disheartening to me is there's no vocabulary to make this easy to talk about in politics. So, Hillary gets a question at the end of the last debate and says, I hope they consider Garland and they approve him, but if not, I'm going to appoint someone who represents the diversity of the country and isn't a judge. That's not very helpful.
Hi, thank you very much. My name is John Jacobs, and I'm a voter who has already voted for Hillary. Assuming that enough people do that, and she gets a chance to appoint one, two, three people during her 8 years, that's another sentence. What of the 40-some years of Republican decisions might be overturned?
So
you mentioned Citizens United, for example.
So I didn't mention Citizens United as being overturned.
No. You just
If you'll forgive some self-promotion, if you get the latest issue of the American Prospect, at great length I answered that question.
You didn't know that I was in favor of that?
So I spent some time talking with lawyers who have been unhappy with court decisions in some areas. Right now, the lawyers who are most critical of Citizens United think that challenging it and trying to overturn it is not where the greatest gains could happen, but rather trying to challenge the idea that there should be no aggregate limits on campaign contributions would be a really good use of legal resources and a potential winner, because the decision by the D.C. Circuit a few months after Citizens United, which did away with aggregate campaign limits, hasn't been considered by the Supreme Court, and so it would be a case of first impression. One of the striking things is that lots of liberals have a fantasy about overturning the Shelby County voting rights case, and that can't happen because the only way it could happen is if the Justice Department were ignoring Shelby County so that it could be sued and that case would go back to the court. But the Voting Rights Act is full of powerful other provisions that can impose preclearance requirements if certain standards are met, and there the Republicans have given plenty of opportunity to bring those sorts of cases. I mean, to me, if you think about what a new justice ought to bring and how that might change the court, is a new justice would be as interested in protecting consumer interests as in protecting corporate interests. A new justice would be as interested in making it easy to vote as being skeptical of what's happening to block people from voting. Then what always happens in with the passage of time is that issues that we think are really important now turn out to be supplanted by others. The court has taken the fastest growth area in the court's docket has to do with patents and intellectual property. And what I don't know about that could fill many volumes of encyclopedias. And that's the case for lots of us. So there are lots of areas where new technology is going to make for new values choices. And the conversation as we've had it up till now will only help so much. But anyway, there's lots of detail in that piece.
Okay, thank you.
David.
David Ignatius, like Jim Fallows, a longtime friend and even a college roommate. Maybe a last question. I'd love to push you on a subject that I know you've thought a lot about, and that is the coverage of the Supreme Court. Most areas of coverage in American journalism are adversarial, and it's striking that the Supreme Court generally, even by the model that you cite, Garrett Epps, is covered in a more respectful way. The institution is studied, journalists have time to read deeply into the subject matter, to attend oral argument. It's just a different kind of coverage. You and I have talked often in the past about the person who, in a sense, is the model for that kind of coverage, Anthony Lewis, and his deep respect for the institution. And so I just would ask you to talk a little bit about whether that tradition of supporting the court, supporting the institution you're covering implicitly in how you do it is on balance a good thing that should be kept, or whether a more adversarial model would produce better results from the standpoint, not of what's good for journalism, but for the country.
Well, Yeah, it's a great question. So Anthony Lewis covered the Supreme Court for the New York Times from 1957 to 1964. He covered the Warren Court in its great years. Lewis was really part of the first generation of overeducated journalists, and until then there was a great a kind of blue-collar tradition in journalism, and Lewis came out of the Harvard Crimson with a bunch of stellar journalists and was more idea-oriented, thought of himself as a peer, literally, when he was the London correspondent for the New York Times, but a peer in the sense of having the intellectual capacity to write about the court the way a justice might think about it. Lewis went to Harvard Law School for 1 year and was a brilliant law student and figured out how to cover the court in a way that set a model for everybody since then. Until then, the court's decision had been covered as what just happened, who won, who lost. Not very much different from sports coverage, except people didn't know the names of the decision makers the way they did on the sports pages. And he covered it as a conversation, the court in a conversation with itself in the past and setting terms of discussion in the future, and also was deeply invested in the court and its importance in the American constitutional system. One really interesting thing about Lewis is that when he became a columnist at a relatively young age and left Washington to go to London, first to be the correspondent, but very quickly to be a columnist, he wrote a lot about the Supreme Court. And by the time his column ended, 32 years after he started it in 2001, he was despondent about the court. The Bush v. Gore changed his view about the court and really its integrity. And in a way, it freed him up to be the best of both perceptions of the court. He was still absolutely adamant about its importance in the American constitutional system and the importance of it living up to its own aspirations and our expectations of it. But on the other hand, he was a ruthlessly straightforward critic of how it had really defaulted on that tradition. And the most fun I've ever had as a journalist was writing Talk of the Town pieces for the New Yorker. And there was an old model and then a new model that took over when Tina Brown became mayor. The old model was mingle and listen for the story and capture the story, but always with some distance. You're not part of the story. And the new model was, you're holding up the tent pole, the story is about you, and writing in the first person is terrific. And the temptation in covering the court is to write for lawyers and to be celebrated by lawyers and to be welcomed by lawyers because you're one step away from justices. And the way the work is done best is by people who don't care about that, who agree with Lewis that the court deserves some reverence from us because of its institutional importance, but who also take a lesson from Lewis at the end of his career, and who are willing to be ruthless in their criticism, respectful of the institution, but not of particular decisions. And it's a balance that every reporter has to strike differently. But I think the crucial lesson is that you should always be a little bit wary of praise from the people that you're reporting on. I'm going to stop there. Thanks so much for.